Good afternoon everybody, and welcome to the wilds of the Kruger National Park. Now, for many of you, you know what's going on here. Of course, you are regular viewers, and it is marvelous to have you along. But as a result of Big Cat Week, there are lots of new viewers, and it's so great to have you too. Please remember, you are on a live safari here on the Sunset Drive in with Safari Live. That rhymes, of course, beautifully. In the northern reaches of the, well, western reaches of the Kruger National Park, northeastern South Africa, southern tip of the African continent. It's wonderful to have you with us. Please ask us questions as we go along. Send us your comments, hashtag Safari Live, if you're tweeting like the white-browed scrub robin just behind us, or questions at wildearth.tv if you'd like to email us. My name is James Hendry. On camera we've got Tebs. That's his thumb there. And on the other vehicle is Scott, and he's being filmed by the diminutive but highly competent Wim Dornbrach. And you'll be happy to know the drone commander Andrew Francis is lurking about the reserve somewhere to show you some of the incredible aerial shots that we have of this magnificent reserve. Just before we get going, just off to the my left-hand side, your right-hand side, is a beautiful little herd of Nyala. That is a female cow. Next to her, a sub-adult cow, and I think there was a young bull in there somewhere as well. My favorite antelope. There's a young bull coming through now. Now that young bull, you can see his hair color is starting to change slightly, and he will eventually turn into a charcoal gray. It's just a glorious afternoon, sitting at about 29 degrees Celsius or 85 degrees Fahrenheit if you happen to work in that tremendously complex imperial system. And our plan this afternoon is to head from here off to Biffleshoek Dam, where we'll have a look what's going on there. The water is drying up yet again. And while many are saying that this is a drought, I wouldn't say we've got quite that far yet. Certainly, we're standing on the precipice of what I think is might be quite a severe drought. And that's as a result of, apparently, the weather boffins tell me, if you can actually have a weather boffin, given the success that the predictions that they have, I'm not sure weather boffin is in fact a real thing. But they tell us that El Nino, which is a weather phenomenon, is going to make this a very dry year indeed. So, as a result of the dry year we had yesterday and the dry year this year, I think we may well be in for a drought. At the moment, not too bad. There's still water around the place. That little bit of rain that we have had has left little pans of water in the blocks. So wherever there's a bit of clay, it's managed to hold some of the water. The dams are definitely very empty, though. Right, without further ado, enough waffling from me, let's carry on. Scott has got something very exciting to show you. I'm going to head off to the dam and see you just now.
Hello, everyone, and it's great to have you on board. That is a vulture, and vultures are notorious for flying in and around areas where there may be a carcass or a kill. And it's a huge thanks to these birds, because when we were out this morning between drives on a little bit of an exploration mission in search of any action, we saw many vultures plummeting out of the sky into the area where we are currently parked right now. And we drove in, couldn't see anything on first inspection, but then took a short walk around, managed to find a carcass as well as the animal that performed the scene or performed the crime. And what we're going to do is we're about to show you exactly what was caught and killed and by who. What's interesting now, and I'm going to point out more as we go along, is that it appears that most of the vultures that were in this area earlier this morning have actually moved off. So as we drove here this afternoon, there wasn't nearly as much clues and signals as there were at about 8:30 or 9 o'clock this morning when we came out. And obviously the vultures have realized that they'd rather move off in search of another kill or carcass that it is not going to be protected.
by the animal that made it. My name is Scott, for those of you who have not met me before, and I'm teamed up with Viam on camera today. As we drive over a lot of these small bushes, don't worry, they're going to pop straight back up behind us, and we know which trees can tolerate a little bit of a beating and others that cannot, and we avoid the ones that cannot be driven over. And that's evident because as you look around us, even though there's a lot of off-roading done in the Savi Sands, there's no clear evidence that the plants are taking any damage, even during the drought that we are currently in. Now keep your eyes peeled. I'm not too sure where this predator is. I know where the killer is, but as we're driving through here, keep your eyes peeled. There is a stealthy predator in and around us. This dead tree up to my right here was absolutely filled with vultures. This morning there was even a leopard-faced vulture here. And I'm hugely disappointed that they've all left because we don't get to show you vultures as much as I'd like to. But I guess it's good news for the predator. Gonna have less of a hard time, and it's also gonna mean that other predators are not going to be attracted to this area. Even predators who do not make a kill may, from time to time, respond to vultures that are dropping out of the sky and look for an easy meal. I was hoping to get into a shady spot, but I don't think that's going to work out. Now, keep scanning very carefully. Some of you may have noticed something already, but I'm going to show you first. There's something straight ahead of us. You've probably already got a glimpse of this carcass. It's a female kudu. A bit of a sad story here. And even though death is a requirement out here for some animals to eat, this female kudu was about to give birth to a tiny little foal. And the predator responsible for catching her and killing her has opened up her stomach and pulled that fetus out. And it'll be interesting to hear who you think is responsible for making this kill. So send through any guesses you would like very quickly to questions@wildearth.tv or #SafariLive on Twitter, and we are going to wait until you tell us who this animal is, what kind of animal this is. You can be as specific as the name of this animal. The leopards of this area, if it is a leopard, have got individual names. The lion coalitions and lion prides have also got a certain name. So, we're in luck, and it looks like we are in for an absolute treat. I didn't expect this. And you can all thank the quarantine male leopard for getting up unexpectedly in the heat of the day and coming across to this carcass. It looks like he may feed on it. He hasn't fed on it since this morning, since we were here. So our timing is incredibly, incredibly lucky. Michelle and I think Gracia have both guessed leopard before we even got you, so well done. Oh, looks like the flies are giving him a hard time. Oh, look at all those flies. Oof. Look at his strength now. That is probably about 300 pounds of kudu, and he's probably maximum about 180, 160 to 180 pounds of leopard. And he's dragging almost double his body weight there. Now what's interesting is that he dragged the small fetus away from this area, probably about 100 meters away, down into a riverbed below us. We couldn't follow exactly where he went. We were sadly not in the small little vehicles that we use for broadcast, and we're in a much longer limousine, which is very hard to negotiate off-road. So we decided to leave him and head down into the riverbed. but he does have another little stash there as well as all this meat here. Now, for him to be able to hoist this kill up into a tree, I don't think is possible. It's twice his body weight and very, very tricky for him to get that wedged into the fork of a tree at the moment. If he manages to feed on it a bit more uninterrupted, oh, there goes some stomach contents, and he's going to probably feed on it like a little piece of spaghetti, sliding it through his front teeth. No, just chomp that bit off. As I was saying though, if he does manage to feed on it for a kind of 24 more hours, then he's got a chance of getting it up into a tree, but the likelihood of him being uninterrupted in the next 24 hours is very, very slim. Either lion or hyena will come into this area and he will give way to both of them. And Polo on YouTube, spot on. This is certainly a very large meal for one leopard. And if he was interrupted, this would be food for easily 5 full days. And he would stay here for 5 full days, even though by the end of it, there would certainly be 1 or 2 maggots jiggling about the carcass. But it wasn't long ago that his mother, a female leopard called Karula, fed on a female and adult grown impala for 5 nights in total. So a nice big meal, but what in all likelihood is going to happen here, look at how he's removing the stomach content there, sliding the stomach lining between his front teeth. Flies are giving him a real hard time there. Imagine having all those flies buzzing around you while you eat your tasty kudu. There's another great display of his strength. Not easy, because there's a lot of vegetation below him, small plants that are preventing that kudu to move further into the shade, which he's trying to do for a couple of reasons: to keep it cool, as well as to keep it out of view of animals like vultures. Hello to Sleepy One on YouTube, and really enjoying all the new viewers who are watching on YouTube and all the different platforms that you can watch. And it's important to know that there are different platforms where you can watch these safaris. So if one is giving you a bit of hard time, it's worthwhile trying a different one, as it may be a little bit better depending on what country you're in. And oh, look at this. And yes, this leopard certainly does have a name. His name is Mr. Q, or Quarantine. And that's for you, Sleepy One, watching on YouTube. Thank you very much for sending your question through. And all the leopard of the Sabi Sands are named. He's named after an area. And quite often leopard are named after areas. Sometimes they're named after traits, whether they skittish or nervous or sneaky or move big distances. There's various ways that animals will be named, but all of the leopards in the Sabi Sands are named. And it's not because we feel like they are our pets, but it's just from a work perspective. It's good to know who's who moves where, keeping track of lineage, knowing who his mother is, knowing who his likely father is, judging by the dominant male in the area when his mother gives birth. Or sometimes you even get to see a female mating with several males, which is actually often the case, and that's why we can never be certain who the father is, because female leopards will often mate with more than one male during one estrous cycle. And I'm told that from one litter, where a female may produce 2 cubs, each cub may have a different father. Fascinating stuff, but apparently that is actually the case. Okay, well, there's a few vehicles getting active now. Ooh, we can smell that now. The wind's blowing straight towards us. Not very good, but I'm going to have to get onto the radio quickly to update Taxon, who's just got out with his guests, on where about we are. Tax, come along Leadwood until you see a Gwari branch. We're about midway along Leadwood, between Drakensberg and Gowrie Main. You'll see the Gwari branch and I'm west of that, so I'll also get your audio. Okay, well that's that little bit of admin out the way. Apologies for that, but imperative that we keep good relationships with all the guides. It could very well be that we were heading out this afternoon with no plans. Oh, look at his claws there. Awesome. And you can see the sheath where they are usually protected and kept sharp. And it's only when they're climbing up trees or latching onto prey that they protract those claws out. And this is an awesome, awesome visual. What we may be able to do later is try and reposition the vehicle. There was a whole big bunch of scratch marks in and around this kudu's neck. And it must have been an almighty wrestling match between this big male leopard. We are getting a seriously awesome show here, everyone. If this is your first live safari, I would like you to do two things. I'd like you to realize how lucky we are and how lucky you are to be getting off to such a great start, and also to let us know who you are and where you're watching. Always good to know there's new people on board and we can chat with you. That is the beauty of these live interactive safaris. Hello to Shell in Detroit and to Noah, who's watching on YouTube. And you guys would both like to know, how old is this leopard? And like I was saying earlier, we don't only know their names and often their lineage, but also their age. And he was basically born almost this time 3 years ago. So a three-year-old male, which makes him independent, not quite fully grown. He's as tall as he will become in all likelihood, but his body is going to fill out, his head is going to become a bit bigger. There's certainly room for a lot more growth, and he'll probably only be in his prime at about 5 years of age to 7 years of age, and could live for up to 15 years, possibly even a little bit longer than that. So he's a youngster, and we've been very, very fortunate in being able to watch him and his brother called Kunyuma quite closely since we arrived here this time last year. And it was him and his brother Kunyuma that we definitely spent more time with in our first 6 months of Safari Live than any other two leopards. We also haven't seen him for quite a long time, so great to have him back on the property. As we watch him feeding on the ground here, wondering what the outcome of this kill is going to be. Will he be able to get it up to a tree at some point? Shrub on Twitter has asked, what is the heaviest weight that a male leopard has hoisted up into a tree? And sadly, Shrub, it's so difficult to have accurate weights on all of these things because they're wild animals, and to be able to have an exact measurement or exact weight would understandably be tricky without getting in the way of the animals and interfering too much. But I've heard tales of fully grown baby, well, a baby giraffe, obviously fully grown and born, being hoisted up into trees, and those will weigh possibly upwards of 100 kilograms. Young zebra foals have also been caught and put up into trees. I've never heard of a kudu being put into a tree, not at least an adult, by a big male leopard, but 200 pounds, their own body weight, is easily achievable, often slightly more. And that same goes for a female. So a 100-pound female, would be able to probably hoist 200 pounds worth of animal up into a tree. There's no guarantees, and it will depend on the individual. Looks like he's finished his snack for now. And we were so fortunate that we got to see him feeding now. It was the last thing I expected him to do. It's very, very hot. And I thought closer to about 6:30 this evening we'd see him take his first mouthful. But that is the joy. What a beautiful shot this is through the foliage. And that is the joy of being on a live safari. You simply do not know what is going to happen and when. Even though there are likely outcomes and likely things to happen, this is a great example of simply not knowing what is going to happen next. So Shrub, back to your question, anything up to their weight and in upwards of that, ever so slightly, they can get up into trees, I guess would be the final answer. Okay, well, good news. You guys are going to be teleported across to a bit of a fun and exciting times across at Buffalsook Waterhole. Put your seat belts on and be ready to be taken up to some altitude. We aren't going to go anywhere and you'll be back with us shortly.
Well, I don't know about exciting, but certainly interesting times at Buffalsook Dam. Thank you, Scott. You can see seven buffalo bulls there that are enjoying this last of the mud that is here at Buffalsook Dam. Now, this dam has not dried up in 20 years' time. And you can see that it is on the verge of drying up. And every time it looks like it's about to go dry, we get a little smattering of rain and the puddles refill and that green, greasy water there maintains. So the buffalo bulls, not too concerned about being in the water today. It's only been about, like we said, 29 degrees Celsius, not Fahrenheit, which is 85 degrees Fahrenheit, and so not too hot for them. They're normally, at this time of the year, used to much, much hotter temperatures, into the hundreds of Fahrenheit. It's normally 102, 103 around there. So they just like to come down to the water. They'll happily drink that water. They'll also go to the loo in it, which is just utterly disgusting, but that's how they operate, and that doesn't seem to affect them at all. They'll also lie down in it and snooze, and just to maintain the kind of coolth of the way, the coolth of the day. Now, what you can see, a very great treat, the drone commander Andrew Francis, you can see how much this has dried out and how the extent of the dam, which you don't necessarily get from a look from the vehicle, you can see the extent of it, but you can also see the greenery. And, well, I'm always astonished at how much less green it looks from the air than it does from the vehicle. So from the vehicle, we're driving through the woodlands, all the trees are bright green, and it looks like everything is verdant and almost tropical. You get into the air like you are now, you can see how it's not the case. The trees don't look nearly as thick, and you can also see in between the trees pretty brown, grey stuff. Not a lot of grass in there at the moment. Lots and lots of sort of weedy stuff and huge gaps between the grass plants, which is not great for the grazers. And if the dry conditions persist, we're going to have very little grass for the grazers to eat. And you can see this huge dam seems like a bit of overkill for this time of the year, especially without the rain. And it's hard to imagine this dam being sort of, well, I guess 10 feet deep at the center at some stages. So that is quite interesting. Right, so totally different perspective now that you've come back to us on the vehicle, and you can see how much greener it possibly looks into the woodland. I'm always amazed at the difference, and it certainly doesn't feel quite as green down on the ground as I think it looks to you. Other interesting things at the dam here, we've got a grey heron, which is the large sort of tall bird there, which we'll zoom into now. And he will be looking for frogs and possibly the odd tilapia to eat. The tilapia had a mass die-off a little while back as a result, I suspect, of two things. One, the heat of the very shallow water, and also all of that algae would have sucked the oxygen out of the water, which would have meant that the fish had nothing to drink at all. Thank you, John, for your question on Twitter. You want to know what is more dangerous, a lion, a leopard, or Brent Leo Smith's boots? There's absolutely no question as to what is the most dangerous of those. Brent Leo Smith's boots are by far the most dangerous things in the world. They, in fact, have been banned in many countries. Brent is not allowed by international law to travel with his shoes on. He has to travel in special sanitized socks. In seriousness though, John, it's actually quite an interesting question, because just the whole concept of danger out here is such a big thing, and people often are convinced that we are taking our lives in our hands by driving around with a camera here, and that we might be set upon by prides of lions around every corner, and leopards might leap on and eat tabs off the back of the vehicle, the buffalo might turn the vehicle over, the elephants might charge us, the hippo might bite us with their great big canine. It's just not like that. We're in a magnificent wilderness area. Yes, it's potentially dangerous in some ways, of course, and I've said this before, but to our new viewers, it's particularly important for you to understand. This is not an inherently dangerous place to be. It's more dangerous walking down a street in New York City, I believe, than it is going for a walk here, as long as you understand how animals are going to react to you on foot. And so that's very crucial. Tibbs seems to have spotted something. Tibbs, oh, brilliant. Tibbs, you've got a woodland kingfisher there. Well done. Now, Pamela, while we're looking at that woodland kingfisher, you say the water looks very ew. It is very ew indeed, Pamela. I wouldn't drink it, especially not after I just watched the buffalo, relieve himself of all forms of waste product into it. I'm sure it's pretty disgusting, and that's why the algal bloom has occurred. Right, let us head it back across to the leopard. Enough talk of this sort of toilet humor, and we will see you a little bit later.
So it seems like he's eventually found a nice shady spot here though. As you can see, he is panting, and it's a very hot afternoon. Thankfully, quite a cool breeze blowing, but he's very low to the ground there, and what little vegetation there is has somewhat of a blanketing effect on him. He's also doing a bit of grooming, as you can see. And isn't it incredible how they camouflage and blend in so well to their surroundings as VM zoomed out there? I hope you enjoyed your flight around Buffleshook Waterhole with James and our drone squadron commander Andrew Francis, who was piloting the drone. We had some great fun with all of the vultures that helped us to find this leopard and the kill this morning. And they were all circling up above us, and Andrew managed to get the drone in and amongst them and got some incredibly wonderful shots that are unique. As usually, you're looking high up into the sky towards the vultures, but this time you were literally in and amongst them and often looking down on them. And for those of you who haven't had a look at Andrew's wonderful videos that he's put together, it's worth checking out and having a look for them. He's done a number of different drone videos. Beam's just pointing out where the kill is in relation to where the leopard is sleeping, and in terms of distance, it's about 20 meters, so not far away at all, and it makes sense for him to stay close by to try and protect it from any intruders, possibly other leopard, but mainly the vultures is one of the main things he'll stand up to. Lion and hyena he will stand down to. Even one single hyena he will typically probably give in to, but there are always unique circumstances, and occasionally male leopards will attack hyena. Well, hello, Jeff Top, and you've tuned in late, so I'm not sure if we are going to punish you for being late by not answering your question about what carcass this is. We may make you wait until a little bit later on, until quarantine resumes feeding on it. Only joking, Jeff. It is a female kudu,
And for any of you who may have also tuned in recently, this female kudu was sadly about to give birth to a tiny little kudu foal or lamb, and that was plucked out of the kudu. We could tell because usually leopard will feed on the rear end, as it did start to do in this case, but it did break open the stomach, and we saw it dragging the young kudu away this morning that it stashed elsewhere. We're not sure exactly where it stashed, but we've got a vague idea of the direction the leopard went in, down towards the riverbed. And that poor little kudu's big ears hadn't even hardened yet. They were very soft and floppy, and was probably going to be born in just a few days. It's not uncommon at this time of the year for heavily pregnant female kudu, as well as impala, to be caught out by a leopard. Understandably, they are a little bit heavier than normal, and they are preoccupied by the process of giving birth in the near future. So there's a lot on their mind, and obviously they become good victims for animals like leopard. One of those things, and it is essential for this leopard to survive, to make kills. And sadly, in this case, it was a female kudu that was about to give birth. I mean, where's the leopard now? Ah, there it is. Okay. Hello, Sean and Secunda. And you would like to know how far away are the hyenas from this kill? Well, the hyena den sites that we know of are probably about a mile and a half to 2 miles as the crow flies from here. So not very far, but we don't know if there are any other hyena just lurking about, sleeping in a riverbed nearby, that could catch wind of this kudu. Like I said, it is a windy afternoon, so this scent will be getting carried far and wide. Also, what we need to remember, and I touched on it this morning, is that we do need to remember that the fact that we only see Juma and Arethusa does not mean that there is not life outside of Juma and Arethusa. And we are, in fact, it's in fact inverted. The majority of life is outside of Juma and Arethusa, and we are the tiny pinprick. So there could be many hyena on the surrounding properties. We are very close to our south eastern border of Juma, and what I'd like to do is actually get out a quick map and be able to show you exactly where we are, and that way you'll know what's what and I can explain a little bit better and what I mean. So if I can ask VM to just pan across onto my camera, my cell phone, this map shows the entire traversing area of Wild Earth and Safari Live. The block on the right here, the top right-hand block, is Juma. The right-hand block over here is Arethusa, okay? So it's funny kind of connection and boundary between Arethusa and Juma. This is the funny strip of Sibambili that I've spoken about before. So our northern boundary kind of, animals can cross straight across from our north western corner into Sibambili, where we cannot follow them, but if they then came further south into Arethusa, we can follow them. So everywhere that is green, we cannot go, but life still exists there and animals can move there. And if you can see where we are here, we are the blue dots right in the southeastern corner of our property. And I'm going to zoom in a little bit just so you can see some of the road names. You are currently up over there with James, northeastern corner. And because we don't know what goes on to the right, to the east, and to the south, it means that there could be hyena den sites, there could be lions, there could be pterodactyls, there could be anything happening there, but we are not going to know exactly what is going on. So that will probably help answer your question as to the hyenas, our hyenas that we know being quite far away, but there could be other ones nearby, Sean. I hope you enjoyed that little map thing. We should probably do that more often to show you guys exactly what's happening. I can hear Tax making his way in, which is the good news. I'm just going to let him know where the leopard is in relation to my vehicle quickly. Tax, the kudu is about 20 meters to my left, and the ingwe is about 10 meters to my left underneath the Pulsar Forum. Okay, very good. So now I've given Tax an update. Like I said, he was going to be making his way here. And I'm just going to reverse an inch or two just so you got a slightly better view of his face. Oh, that's not reverse, that's forward. There we go. Shell asks a very good question, and happy to have you on board with us, Shell. Why does he lie so far away from his kill if he is in fact protecting it? And it's probably to stay away from the flies, Shell. There's going to be a lot of flies attracted to that kill, and leopards don't like flies. You can even see now he's twitching his head from side to side because flies are bothering him. You get little flies, you'll see some possibly on his ears. I think I can see one or two. Oh, well, there's one right on his nose. But a lot of these flies are biting flies. And obviously, it's painful and not much fun. But, Shell, do not fear. An animal of a leopard's speed and agility will be able to cover 20 meters in under a second. So his response time to that carcass is going to be very, very quick if in fact he does need to get there. Hello to Scott Burns, the wonderful name you have, watching on YouTube. And you're right, this is a remarkable sighting, and aren't we privileged to be here sharing this with one another? Scott's interested to know how long will he hang on to this kudu for? And Scott, it all depends on luck. If in an ideal world, no hyena or lion give him a hard time, or in that fact, even his father, a big male leopard, is about 10 years old now, called him Vula, unless they come and give him a hard time and chase him off his kill, he could very well have enough food for 5 days here, very easily. In reality, what will happen, only time will tell. He could have this kill stolen from him by a clan of hyena tonight, and then all that he'll have left is the small fetus that he has stashed away down in a riverbed nearby. But certainly easily 5 days, if uninterrupted. Which would be wonderful for us, because it would mean we will all be watching leopard for the next 5 days with no racing about and pulling out of hair whilst trying to track these elusive and hard to find animals down. What's very important to understand is the amount of luck that goes into finding these animals combined with skill is quite scary. I mean, this morning we headed out at about 9 o'clock, and we were just coming out on a drive just to see what we could see. No major goals or ambitions. And we saw about 4 or 5 vultures plummeting out of the sky, not too many. And as they plummeted out of the sky, we raced into the area, and we noticed that already many, many more vultures had already landed. Predominantly white-backed vultures, but even one leopard-faced vulture, the heavyweight boxer of all the vultures. He's the top of the vulture food chain. And they obviously established that this leopard is not going to give them half a chance to actually come down and feed on the kill. So they've all moved off elsewhere in the hope that they will be able to find a carcass that they are allowed to feed on. As we headed here this afternoon, absolutely no sign of any vultures. And without vultures, it would have been incredibly difficult to find them. And Debbie in Florida, like I've just said, the reason why those vultures would have left the carcass is because they've done the maths. They've come here, they've assessed the situation. Obviously, the tricky thing for a vulture, now imagine, the first vulture that saw this kudu would have been like, awesome, let me come down and see what's going on. So it came down. Now, vultures can see incredibly well. They can see a 5-centimeter little disc of meat from a kilometer in the sky. They can see vultures plummeting from about 3 to 5 kilometers. So that's about 2 to 3 miles that they can see other vultures plummeting. And that effect has a chain reaction. If one vulture starts heading in a certain direction and then another vulture starts heading in a certain direction, all the vultures that spread out far and wide see this kind of movement into a general area. And then all the vultures start heading in to that area. And as they get into the area, because they can fly, it's quite easy to kind of do a loop around and see what the commotion's all about. So they all would have seen this kudu here, a lot of meat, probably a little bit more difficult to see the leopard. But once they've landed, had a look around, realized that this leopard knows what's going on, realized that this leopard is not going to give up the kill, they thought, well, it's probably time to move off and try their luck elsewhere. So they can travel very quickly, very, very long distances in order to assess a kill, but it's not uncommon for them to leave, possibly return another day, maybe return tomorrow, knowing that there may be some scraps here, but to wait probably a long, long time wouldn't have made sense for the vultures. There may be one or two lurking about, but I haven't seen any, not one, other than the one we saw flying past as we started out. But what I may predict is that a battleur eagle or a hooded vulture may swoop down this afternoon. Those are kind of the most effective in terms of quick flights in and out. The other vultures are more long distance travelers and are less prone to kind of pop in for a quick look and then leave. So the smallest vulture, the hooded vulture, as well as a carrion eating eagle called the battleur, are going to be the most two likely kind of carrion eaters that we will see here this afternoon. To James Taylor in Virginia. And James raises a sad but important topic, and that is the topic of vultures being poisoned. Now, sadly, in Africa, a lot of the local people have got very strong beliefs about traditional medicines, and a lot of wild animals are regarded as the most effective of these medicines, vultures being one of them. And traditional doctors will therefore try their best to get as much vulture as they can, different parts of vulture. Some probably the eyes will be used to help people with eye problems. There's often, very often, a direct kind of relation between an animal's strengths, like a vulture's eyesight, and the human's disability, having bad eyes. So anyway, vultures are sought after for medicine and are poisoned, thankfully not on Juma and not on Arethusa. This area is very well patrolled by anti-poachers, and the animals here are protected with a very high degree. Surrounding areas, it could still be a problem. I did hear a horrible story quite recently of a number of vultures being poisoned not too far away, often by farmers who are none the wiser. But it is something, James Taylor, that is not happening as commonly as it was before. And I think the world over, people are becoming more conservation friendly and more conservation conscious. So we are heading in the right direction, I think, as a majority. We need to make sure the minority that's pulling us back and causing trouble for the animals start getting educated on what is right and what is wrong. Hello to Zimbo, and apologies to hear that you are nursing a broken wrist over in London, but very happy to hear that you are on safari with us. And what a good way to mend a broken wrist whilst being on safari. Perfect. Now, you have heard that vultures cannot break into a carcass. They will need to rely on other predators to do so. And it is true to a degree. But the leopard-faced vulture that we spoke about a little bit earlier is the individual who will be capable of breaking into carcasses and opening them up for other animals. Another thing to remember, Zimba, it obviously depends what kind of carcass. If it is a rhino or an elephant, it's unlikely that even the leopard-faced vulture would be able to open it up. But for smaller animals and your regular kind of herbivores, like a kudu with skin that's thick but not too thick, this is the tool that will be used when no other carnivores are around. It's a massive, massive beak attached to a massive, massive bird. It's about a 12-pound bird, about a meter in height. And the interesting thing is, these vultures are often the ones that actually try and eat the skin, the tendons, and the ligaments that are too tough for the other vultures, and seldom actually takes the meat. So their primary role is actually opening up the carcass. And then these smaller vultures will be the ones that come in afterwards. We don't see the Cape vulture as often as I would like, but it's got a bright yellow eye, so that's one we could see. The white-backed vulture and the hooded vulture, and those are the most likely to see here. And that's interesting, because there was a second part to Zimbo's question, and she was interested to know, will certain vultures target specific parts of the kill? And I've already started answering that with the leopard-faced vultures, Zimbo. Yes, they will feed on the skin, the ligaments, the tendons, not so much the meat. The Cape vulture and white-backed vulture will be the ones that are going to be feeding on the majority of the meat. And the hooded vulture, he's got a tiny little beak, and perfect for kind of getting into all those gaps. Also a much smaller head than the other birds and a smaller body. It can then kind of pick off all the meat between the ribs and all the little tiny little titbits that are left over. So they each have their little hierarchical spots, and that makes the most sense in being effective in cleaning up these carcasses quickly and efficiently. So they've all got their little roles. There's the white-headed vulture, which I forgot at the bottom here, so let's just show it to you. That would be rude if we forgot the white-headed vulture off the list. And we actually, I managed to show you the first one just yesterday or the day before that I've managed to see on Safari Life flying past. Also very big, but not quite as big as the leopard-faced vulture. And interestingly enough, they do quite a lot of hunting and will kill small animals more so than other vultures. But certainly, like the whole family, they are professionals at finishing off leftovers of other animals. Good. Thank you for that question, Zimbo. I hope your wrist heals soon. Now you have got a better idea of how lucky we were to start off the safari within minutes, a minute probably, of arriving. He was up on the move and feeding on that kudu, pulling it around. If some of you missed that, apologies, but next time you should be on time and be punctually for the start of the safari, otherwise you may miss such things. But now he sits and waits, and a tricky thing, I'm almost thinking it may be worth going for a drive around, not right now necessarily, but it may be worth heading off and seeing if we can find anything else, and coming here when it does cool down. Because my predictions at this stage is that he is not going to be doing too much other than relaxing in the shade. Hello to Joanne on email, and Joanne is interested to know, on average, is a male leopard bigger than an adult female hyena? And yes, I would say that most often in this area, you will find a big male leopard. Oh, thank you for proving me wrong. This is what animals do best. I said he's probably not going to do anything, and all of a sudden he gets up. So that's perfect. We are happy with this and love to see big cats on the move. So So, Joanne, yeah, male leopards will always be slightly bigger in this area than female hyena, but it will vary from time to time, and every animal out here has got slightly different sizes, slightly different personalities to the next one. But what's interesting about that is even though they are slightly bigger than the female hyena, they will still not risk an encounter with them. And why would you? You've got no medical aid out here. The risk of an injury from an animal that has the most powerful jaws in the business doesn't really make sense. And most often, wild animals will avoid fights at all costs. Probably a lesson us as humans could learn. I think we're far more violent as a species than most animals. But Joanne, to be honest, just one last thing. The trickiest thing about your question is that I've never weighed a hyena, and I've never weighed a leopard. And specifically in this area, it would be no good to weigh a leopard in Kenya and a hyena in Cape Town, because animals in different areas of Africa will have different sizes. So it's very tricky to know the exact weights of the animals in this area. Hello everybody. How are you doing?
Yourself,
very good, thanks.
It was very interesting listening to you.
Well, I'm glad you're finding it interesting. I'm sorry for the parts that are not. So we're just chatting with the vehicle that's next to us. They've squeezed into a better spot. They didn't have the best view initially, and I'm actually thinking of possibly trying to move out of our spot so that we can give them a chance to have a view of his face. Because imagine coming all the way to Africa and only seeing a leopard's tail. It would be a bit disappointing. Okay, well that's perfect. We're going to send you across to James for an update. I'm going to reposition and let Tax get his guests a better view, and we'll catch up a little bit later.
Right, so we've come to another waterhole now. Well, we're on our way to another waterhole. And while we go there, what we're going to do is give you another aerial view. Now, while Scott, of course, is sitting with the highlight of Juma at the moment, quarantine, we're going to do a few experimental things and show you a few things from the air. Now, this is particularly important for our newer viewers who perhaps don't have an idea of the lay of the land quite like some of the more regular ones. And so I hope you enjoy these aerial shots. We're driving towards a dam called Treehouse Dam at the moment, and what you're going to notice is, well, first of all, you'll see us driving along. We'll give you a bit of a wave there, and then you're also going to see a number of game paths, or very obvious paths worn by animals as they move towards Treehouse Dam and what used to be a very important part of the water balance of this area. Now, I have always amazed again from the air to see how many of these paths there are. They're worn by all sorts of animals, from impala to elephant to rhino to hippo to buffalo and warthog and everything else that needs the water. And you can see them all converging on Treehouse Dam now. You can probably also see a little bit in the way of the mud there at Treehouse Dam. That's the last sort of mud that there is there. And again, this dam went completely dry at one stage. There's little bits of rain, still seem to manage to fill up the bits of sort of mud at the end. And now you're going to see us as we come through the trees. Voila, there we are. The drone commander is flying like a Spitfire pilot during the war. I can't actually see him because he's flying straight with the sun. He's very clever. So we're going to stop here on the dam wall, give you another wave, rock and roll style. And not a lot going on here, you can see. There are a few impala around. They probably had a little bit of a drink. They may have tried to drink out of this muddy water. I suspect what they were doing, though, was eating a little bit of the sort of greenery that's come up amongst the clay here. And there's a bit of grass. There are a few sort of odd plants and bits and pieces that the impala will eat. So just amazing to see how little water there is, but Of course, as I think Scott explained this morning, lots and lots of water around the place. If you happen to be, if you happen to be on some of the other reserves, there are many dams that are pumped by people, and that, of course, changes the entire species composition of an area. So perhaps very different species composition from what it was, say, 300 years ago, but still a wonderful place to be. All right, so given that there is only one laughing dove standing here at Treehouse Dam, I don't think we're going to linger for long. Let us press on and see what else we can see. It's a rather magnificent afternoon. Like I was saying, not too hot, but cooler than we're used to at this time of the year. I'm never going to complain about that. It can get very beastly hot, as I said. And what you're going to see us doing now from the air is we're going to turn to the west towards the, well, not quite setting sun yet, but should we say dipping sun as it heads towards the horizon. And the idea is now to head towards the very western edge of the reserve and maybe get a little update from Arethusa and see what's going on there. And then as the sun does set, we're going to head towards the hyena den and try and figure out what on earth is going on there. So we had a wonderful picture sent through today from the Twitterverse, and I forget unfortunately the name, but a brilliant picture of, because I was going on and on today about the fact that at the hyena den, the twins, the twin hyenas that we found at the Philemon's Dip den the other day, I said one of them has been killed obviously because there's only one left there. Now Inga then sent through a picture of two baby cubs, one from yesterday and one from today, and they certainly look very different. It is possible that that's the angle, and one of them certainly had her face screwed up. It's possible it's the angle, but it is also possible that I'm wrong and that both those twins are at the den there and only one of them was out today. So we're going to go back there when it cools down a bit and we'll go and see what's happening. I really hope that that 7-week-old cub will come out, unlike she did this morning. She was just so scared to come out today. So fascinating to find out what's going on there. And Debbie, we didn't hang around at the den later today. And just remember, a hyena is closely related to a cat and therefore is a cub, not a pup. And Debbie, you want to know, did we wait? We didn't wait around there. So I'm not sure what happened to the 7-week-old, if she did come out and eventually have a bit of a suckle mother. I suspect eventually she would have. But we'll go and find out what's happening there a little bit later. Keep watching, and please keep sending through your ideas as to what's going on there. Wonderful to have that picture from Inga. Now you're back in the sky. I actually can't see the drone at this stage. It may be filming the Drakensberg, for all I know. But a wonderful long-range view, apparently, that you have now of us driving along up towards Philemon's cut line. And I think also quite nice for you to see the road network. It's quite a Sabi Sands is renowned for the sort of density of the roads that it has, and that makes sort of one of the things that makes the game viewing so good. You can also see our southern boundary there, which is called the Gowrie Main Road. And that's that big main road that you can see probably on the left, I'm guessing on the left hand side of your screen. And it's gone out of shot now, apparently. It was on the left-hand side of your screen, I think. And that's our southern boundary. And so, important that you can see, if you are a new viewer, you will be able to see that there are no fences bounding us. So those roads are boundaries that we can't cross, but the animals are free to come and go as they please. And that's just the most wonderful thing. So we sit in a contiguous wildlife area of about 8 million acres, or 3.5 million hectares, which is a giant piece of land, three times the size of Yellowstone National Park, about the same, so it's bigger than Israel, actually. It's an enormous piece of land that we are very privileged to call home. There you see us driving underneath the drone. Dear, a very interesting comment you've made on the drone. Dear, you say you wonder if birds of prey would go after the drone. Now, the drone commander is not known for his reticence or his sort of caution. So he has followed a number of birds of prey with that drone, one of the first of which was a bataleer. And it was interesting to watch. The bataleer did keep looking over his shoulder at the drone, but didn't seem to react too badly. He just tried to sort of get away from it. And there was definitely no attempt to try and attack the drone. But that said, I wouldn't get too close to a martial eagle or something like that, sort of a bird, or especially maybe an African hawk eagle that was about, you know, that are used to catching birds on the wing, or an animal that's, you know, a bataleer tends to be more of a scavenger. So I wouldn't go after an eagle or bird of prey that was used to catching things in the air, mainly because I think the bird would probably hurt itself. You know, those rotors do whip around quite fast. So Andrew was quite careful of that. And then he was up amongst this incredible, and I'm sure you'll post this soon, this incredible array of vultures soaring above around where quarantine is today, with the drone in the middle of them. And it's the most incredible picture. Thank you, James Chapman. I'm glad you're back on YouTube. It's going well, thank you, and I hope it's going well with you. Let's head back to quarantine with Scott, and we'll keep driving along here, see what other interesting bits and pieces we can find. See you later.
Well, very happy to hear that one of our new viewers who discovered these live safaris this morning has joined in again. James Chapman, and isn't this a pleasant surprise for you? Day one on Safari Live and you've already met Mr. Q, a very well-known leopard amongst the Safari Live family. And I really love these shots when there's a few kind of dappled foliage in the way. Andreen, I cannot fault your thought process. Andreen says she doesn't like the sound of Mr. Q. She prefers the sound of Master Q. And we can try and change over to that. But as always, everybody is going to have a slightly different name or variation thereof for these animals. It's throughout the industry, everybody likes to tweak the names. But I like your thoughts there, Andreen. And you're right, he certainly has filled out since we last saw him. I can't remember when last I did actually see him. And it would be wonderful if we can actually somehow in the future be able to understand the weights of these animals without actually physically having to dart them and or weigh them. Because it would be great to monitor their weights as they grow up. Now, I'd like to show you something. Some pictures from this morning, and it may be a little bit hard for you to for some of you to see. It is pictures of him dragging away the fetus of the kudu, but I'm sure a lot of you may find this interesting. So if you're not interested in watching, turn your heads temporarily. It's nothing too graphic, but there is a little baby kudu with its floppy ears being dragged off by Master Q, and those aren't going to be too good for you. Sorry about that. But yeah, that was this morning. And just thought we'd give you a quick glimpse of what was happening earlier on. Very good. Now, I've been waiting for this question to come through, so well done to Mark in Cape Town for being the one who asked it. And it is, do I think he intentionally dragged the kudu fetus further away, knowing that if any other predators come into this area, They too could find it and then steal it, and by moving it away from the crime scene, it means he's got a better chance of running off if lions or hyena come, and then being left alone in peace while he finishes that off. And Mark, you're spot on. That's exactly what he is doing. And it's showing great skill for a relatively young and inexperienced leopard. He's only really been fully independent, let's say, for the last year. Now, I must be careful with these stats because he was fending for himself when I arrived a year ago, but he was still within his mother's territory. So he was kind of living at home, but he had a waitering job that was keeping him going, but still getting looked after a lot by his mother and still stealing a lot of her kills. So when he couldn't catch something, he would just run around until eventually he would find mom, and he would overpower her, and even though she would hiss and snarl at him, he would be able to eat his delight or eat to his content and then move off. Now that has changed. Probably from about March or April this year, we started seeing less and less of him, and probably since then we've only seen him a handful of times. He's moved further to the south and to the east of us, and in that time that he's been gone, he's been fine-tuning the skills of hunting, and not only catching the prey but dealing with it once it has been caught. And I think this is a good example of that skill and wisdom that comes with time. Move part, a portion of the kill away, and then come back to the main part that cannot be moved any further. So good move, Mr. Q. Questions coming through on the topic of the kudu fetus. Penny Pine and Ellen Fowler are interested to know whether I think the kudu was giving birth when Mr. Q latched onto her, or was she going to give birth in a few days' time. And I'm under the impression that she was still probably going to give birth only in a few days' time. And the reason why I think that is because, oh, it's difficult. I don't know. I've just got that gut feeling that that is what happened. But maybe I'm wrong. It's so hard to tell. I mean, the only portions of the carcass that had been fed on when we arrived here was basically what you saw earlier on. The one rib cage being opened up and a tiny bit of the rump around the tail being chewed on. Other than that, it's... So with just that information, it's very difficult to work out whether it was in the process of giving birth or... It certainly hadn't given birth yet. That baby kudu had not been born. Maybe some of its legs were poking out of the rear end of the female, but I do not think it had been actually born just yet. And that's just my gut feel. We are going to have to ask Mother Nature for any further details, sadly, Ellen and Penny Pine. Sorry, I cannot be of more assistance there. Well, Donna's interested to know, why has this leopard not removed the stomach contents of this kudu yet? And will it? Because Donna knows that lions will do that. And it certainly will, Donna. It's just that it's got time, well, it doesn't have time on its side, but it doesn't have competition of other pride members and help of other pride members to chew through all that kudu. So it's fed on as much as it can, and when it gets to the point where it needs to remove those stomach contents to access more meat, oh, big yawn. You may do another one, so be ready with your screenshots. They tend to let them off in kind of bursts of two and three. He may well, I've just lost my train of thought completely here. So we'll just sit in silence while I try and work out what it was I was saying. Apologies. Well,
Well, it seems like Robert and myself have got similar tastes when it comes to looking at these beasts, and enjoys having the kind of blurry foreground with the piercing eyes poking through. Interestingly enough, Viam mentioned, who's on camera with me this afternoon, that this is a very contrasty leopard, meaning that the markings are very bold and there is a very large contrast to him compared to others, and I couldn't agree more with Viam. So that probably adds to the effect of the sighting. Panting away, lacking the ability to sweat like I am at the moment, which I'm quite happy to be doing. I'm quite happy to be sweating as opposed to panting, as I'm sure a lot of you are. I imagine if you had to listen to me panting all afternoon, Archer, that wouldn't be much fun. But some of you may have just heard me take a sip of my water with a massive ice block in the middle of the bottle. Hello to Sharon in Pittsburgh, one of our regular viewers. And she would like to know, when will the leopard's dewlap start developing? And a dewlap is a kind of extra flap of skin that will hang below the throat and neck and even stomach of a big male leopard, and anywhere from 5 to 7 years of age, but it does get bigger and more pronounced the older they get. But certainly, like I say, for me, 5 to 7 is the age where leopards really come into their prime. Some slightly younger than others, just like humans. Woodlands kingfishers, chick, brrr, calling around us, a Cape turtle dove as well. Croo, croo, roo. Croo, croo, roo. Good question through from Kevin on YouTube, and that is one thing that I hope may happen. Let me just ask, relay Kevin's question first though. Kevin's interested to know that if hyena or lion come into this area, what will this male leopard do? Will he run off knowing that they'll probably consume everything, or will he lurk around and try and poach a few titbits? And leopards are very cunning animals, Kevin, and they are highly, highly likely to try and stick around and sneak the odd little bits from a carcass. And what often does happen is that hyenas will come and get so caught up in fighting with one another that they'll leave one of the kudu's legs at one side of the crime scene, and the leopard will run in, poach it and run away up a tree. So there certainly are ways of animals like leopards being able to get portions of their kill back. What could also happen is that a hyena could come in, and I've actually had an incredible sighting with this same leopard. He had caught a large nyala at Buffalsook Waterhole, where you were with James a little bit earlier, and he was busy feeding on it when a hyena came running into the scene. He got up, left the hyena to feed on it, and he was lying probably 3 or 4 meters away from the hyena, close, lying down patiently. Not a worry in the world. The hyena was eating, the leopard didn't put up a fight, the hyena's happy, the leopard was happy, there was enough meat for everyone. Another hyena then came in. Those two hyenas started squabbling over the remains of the nyala, and the hyena that was first there started pulling the nyala backwards towards quarantine male, who eventually like kind of had to get up and be like, I don't want to get involved in your trouble. Yeah, eventually the two hyena left, quarantine came back and continued feeding. So these strange things do happen here. I have seen footage of a hyena feeding on one end of a carcass and a male leopard feeding on another. So simultaneously. So bizarre things do happen, but leopards will stick around. They definitely will. Those of you will remember the two Nat Geo shows we did live to TV in October when Peter Pretorius was lucky enough to be on site with Shadow and an impala that was literally still kicking. Shadow, a female leopard, was busy suffocating her. Two hyena came in, started feeding on it. Other hyena came, they got a bit confused with one another. The hyena went off, Shadow came in, got some more meat, ran off. The hyena got the majority of the meat, but she definitely did get some back. Another interesting story, one more, and that involves this leopard's brother called Kunyuma. And there was a coalition of two big male lions here on Juma who killed a Cape buffalo. Very large prey, about 1,500 pounds of meat, rather. Not a 1.5 ton buffalo, that would be scary. 1,500 pounds of meat. anyway, the two male lions had caught the buffalo. Kunyuma, this leopard's brother, was nearby. We had seen him nearby that night. And when I found the buffalo with the lion in the morning, I asked myself, did that leopard hear the buffalo being killed? And is he lurking nearby? It's not uncommon for these young males, or any leopard really, to even sneak into a pride of lion's kill to steal some meat. I've seen it happen before. And the same thing happened with his brother. He lurked around this buffalo carcass. We didn't get any confirmed footage of him stealing anything while they fed on it for about 2 days. But once they finished that Cape buffalo, Kunyuma was straight in there literally seconds after they disappeared, and he was chewing on the hoof of a buffalo up in a tree above us. So they will certainly sneak about, and they know they are masters of disguise and disappearing, and they back themselves. So clever animals, the leopards. And they will take chances from time to time, especially with sniping a piece of meat. Mauricia and Texas and Christina are both interested to know about when he may start looking for girlfriends. And in and around that 5 to 7 year old mark is when they come into their own, and it's unlikely that he would mate before then, but there is a chance he would. And that's not to say that he's incapable of mating now, but it's just in typical kind of leopard life, he's probably only going to be allowed to learn the challenges of mating and learn how to mate when he does get to that age. If we put him and a female leopard in a box right now for the next 3 months, there's a strong chance that they would work out how to mate sooner than he naturally would in the wild. But that is in an unnatural scenario. So, where Mother Nature's in control, anywhere between 5 and 7 would be your likely mating age. Okay, well, we've got some good news. James has been out searching tirelessly for some other animals and has finally found a beautiful big specimen for you.
Hello everybody, we're just watching a big magnificent elephant bull here. We are looking at him from the sky as well, and I'm not going to look at you, I'm going to just watch this elephant carefully. He is watching us quite carefully, and he has been watching us as we drove in here. He can unquestionably hear the drone above him. Whether he associates that with us or not, I'm not sure. And here he comes a little bit closer. So we're just going to sit here very carefully and quietly and just try and assess his behavior. Remember, the crucial part of everything we do here is maintaining the trust of the animals here. And we do try different things, like with the drone. And once, you know, it took a while for them to get used to the vehicles, and now we're trying to get them used to things like that drone. So we very cautiously, very quietly, just try and sort of introduce new things to the animals. And with a big bull like this, well, you don't want to irritate him too much. This is 6 tons of gentle giant, but very quickly becomes 6 tons of very angry fury if you irritate him on the wrong day. So we're now sitting about 30 meters from him, 20 meters from him. Now, while we watch this elephant, which is in complete contrast to the leopard that you've just been watching. Safari, do you want to know what percentage of the time the animals spend relaxing? You couldn't get two more different examples. Leopards and lions will sleep for almost 80%, 80 to 90% of the time. They will be doing absolutely nothing. This elephant, to maintain his body weight, however, probably only sleeps for 3 or 4 hours of the day, and often that's just a quick doze in the shade before he moves on and keeps eating. So, Safari D, not a lot of time spent sleeping if you happen to be a herbivore, especially an enormous one like this. Very good question. The herbivores in general will relax far less than the carnivores, and that's because their food isn't quite as rich, and their real sort of the nutrient that they, or macronutrient that they lack the most from their food, is protein. Protein is difficult to get just from the plants that we have out here, and obviously that's not a problem for the cats. The cats, on the other hand, only eat protein, very lean meat, very little fat. And that means to can make energy, to make the kind of sugars and glucose needed to make the body go function, it's expensive. To digest protein and create energy from it is expensive. You can do it with fat a lot more easily, but there's very little fat on any of the savanna animals that we have out here. For your very, very kind comment. Well, I think it's kind. You say that you feel like you're going to school every day. It's not a feeling I would relish, I must confess, but I think you mean that you're learning a lot every day. Cat, you know, we learn probably as much as you do every day. I'm just going to sit very quietly. He's coming, he's investigating us, he's looking at us quite carefully. He's definitely watching us. And I think there's a certain amount of inquisitiveness, curiosity amongst these elephant bulls. You know, they spend the day alone eating, and when they have a little bit of entertainment in the form of us sitting watching them, I think they quite enjoy it sometimes. There we go. Isn't he lovely? And Ashley, you sent through an update that you saw an elephant bull on Juma Dam Cam, and he was having a mud bath, and you wonder if it might be the same one. Ashley, I'd say more than likely, yes, the same bull. We're quite close to the Juma Dam Cam, so probably the same there. You can see his incredibly dexterous trunk. They've been eating those trees. It looks like a... it looked like a weeping wattle tree there, or the remnants thereof. I've certainly been eating a lot of those of late. Isn't he lovely? I'm just going to let him walk out onto the clearing so that we can go around him without him coming back into this thick bush. I think it's going to be well worth spending a bit of time with this old bull. What have you got there? There's a rock there at his feet. Watch this. Now, I tell you why I find this so fascinating is that I've so often driven, or I used to drive along roads in these reserves, and you find a big rock in the middle of the road, and you think, how on earth did that get there? And I remember then watching an elephant bull like this one day, picking the rock up gently and placing it in the middle of the road. You can see there that he took a little bit of entertainment from that rock. I don't know what kind of block that is. It looks like it's possibly not naturally made. It wasn't made by the environment out here. I'm not sure what it is. We'll go and have a look once he's moved off. And there's no question he's watching us right now. Janet, very nice comment from you. You're in Baltimore, and really nice to hear you from you all the way from there. I bet it's pretty chilly there at the moment. You say you watched a Nat Geo show the other day, and they told you that an elephant bull will eat its own body weight in 20 days. Well, this elephant probably weighs about 6 tons. I would have said that he would eat about 250 kilograms a day. So in 20 days, that would put him at about 5 tons of food, 5,000 kilograms. So yes, I suppose they do. About 20 days to eat their own body weight. I was wondering how much we eat in a day, how much food we eat, maybe about 3 kilograms. And in 20 days, it's not too far off our own body weight, you know. He's fascinated by us. He's having a very good look. And he's also going to play with his pet rock. And just look how that trunk has that incredible array of what concertina muscles, so you can stretch it out and then retract it just like a sort of concertina. Now he's definitely saying to us, I'm watching you. See how he's lifted his ears out there? Sometimes these bulls can get a little bit, I don't like to use the word aggressive, they can get a little bit irritated, and then they can kind of take a chance and maybe come and sort of investigate and be a bit bullysome. I don't think he's going to do that. But there's no reason for him to be where he is now other than to watch us. He's not eating, he's pretending to eat, he's just picking the odd bit of grass and then blowing it up. You can see him standing there underneath the marula tree. Huge marula tree, which will start to fruit fairly soon. Unless it's a male, in which case it will never fruit. It does look like a male, I don't think it's got any fruits on it at all. Great. Even pretending to feed, it's called a displacement behavior, so he's feeling a little bit awkward, obviously, just enjoying himself, but wanting to make out that he's not affected, he's not watching us. He's hiding behind a leadwood tree, a little leadwood tree. And there you can see the hair in his tail. While we're looking at this elephant, as he stands in the sun, Randall, you want to know, you're talking to us from YouTube, in the YouTube stream. You want to know if South Africa has cold winters. Randall, it depends entirely on where you are in South Africa. Some parts of South Africa have pretty cold winters. The coldest area in the country is a place called Sutherland, and that will drop probably to minus 10 fairly regularly during the year, and going up to a maximum in the middle of the day of probably around 10 degrees Celsius. So that's all in Celsius. And then in this area, it doesn't get cold. It gets to about 4 degrees Celsius, which is pretty chilly. But in the middle of the day, normally 22 or 23 degrees Celsius in the middle of winter. So very pleasant, mild winters that we have out here. All right, there's our elephant bull. I'm going to spend a little bit more time with him, but while I do that, let's send you back to the leopard and Scott. Now, Quarantine is the leopard. Scott is not the leopard. Enjoy it, and we'll see you a little bit later.
So other than us repositioning the vehicle, not too much has changed here. Mr. Q is still panting away, and it is still very hot. I believe you have been torturing James with chats of cold winters, and wouldn't that be nice to be in a nice cold place now? Now, there's many South Africans that have never seen snow. I saw snow for the first time when I was 21 years of age, and it required me to travel across to Aspen in Colorado. Not a bad place to start my snowy debut. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could track leopards through the snow? And there are snow leopards, so maybe one day we will take you on a snow leopard safari live adventure. It's certainly worth keeping all these dreams alive, because there are many places we can go on safari, not just here in the Sabi Sands, not just elsewhere in Africa, but the entire planet has got some incredible places and incredible wildernesses and incredible animals that live within them that I certainly would like to see before it's too late, either for me or for the animals. Well, I'm giggling because one of our long-standing viewers and leopard identification experts, Raisa, has just joined in onto the show. And hello, Raisa. Because of all of your hard work and commitment to Safari Live, we have no problem with updating you on what has happened, even though you have tuned in late. And don't worry about asking to do that in the future again. Basically, Raisa, what happened was we came out on drive this morning at about 10 o'clock between drives, and we found some vultures circling in this area, or actually plummeting out of the sky. Drove in off Cheetah Cut Line, and we kind of between Cheetah Cut Line and Ledwood Road, so in the southeastern corner of Juma. And what we did was drove in, found the vultures, couldn't see any kill or predator initially, took a very short and slow walk around until eventually I saw the kudu and I saw Q lying nearby. We then came in with the vehicle and saw Q drag a fetus off down into the riverbed, and then came back here. He returned to this kill to make sure the vultures didn't steal any of it. The vultures have all left. He's had a small snack on the kudu at the start of the safari and hasn't touched anything yet. So we did get lucky early on, because I certainly wasn't expecting him to move during that hot first part of the safari. And now he's relaxing, right? So good to know you are with us. And apologies for whatever delayed you getting on safari. Oh, Joey, who's just 8 years old, has stumped me, and it's often the younger children who ask the most difficult questions. Joey would like to know, how many teeth does a leopard have in its mouth? And I actually don't know, Joey, but I would guess that it's got about 5 or 6 in the front, another 5 down each side, so I'd say 15 on each jaw. I would say about 30 teeth in that mouth. But and I'm a little bit off. There's 32, I'm told. Nikki thankfully did some quick research for me in the final control room, and they have 32 teeth, 4 of which are those long sharp canines. So there we go, Joey, 32 teeth, and 4 of which are the very sharp ones that you can see every now and then. Oh, there we go. Now we can see them, now that he's panting.
Well, very happy to hear from Barbara. She sent through some information saying that they saw a baby giraffe hoisted up into a tree, I think in the Pilanesberg National Park. And thank you very much for sending that through, Barbara. Did you see the leopard in the tree next to it? Do you have any photos you can tweet? It'd be really wonderful to know a little bit more about that. But it certainly must have taken you by surprise. It is not a very common thing to see. I've never seen a giraffe up in a tree. So I'm happy for you that you did. And I hope that you got to see the big male leopard that was responsible for doing that. Not long ago, the Anderson male leopard, one who we don't see very often, sadly, did manage to catch a baby giraffe south of us, and he too hoisted it up into a tree. Well, the animals are certainly playing along with us this afternoon. Not so much this morning, for those of you who were on the Sunrise Safari. It was quite tough out here. But very happy to hear that James is still with that big elephant bull and would like you back on his vehicle to enjoy that sighting.
So we're still with this elephant, as Scott says, and I'm just trying to get a picture of him with this virtual reality rig that we have on the front of the car, that great bubble full of GoPro cameras. But he's, you know, I'm not convinced that he's that comfortable with us. He keeps going into the thicker stuff as soon as we get sort of near him. So I'll just park the car here. Try and get one last good view of him as he destroys that tree. Ooh, look at this. He's also been very unkind with the light. I know it's very difficult for Tebs to film him. That is amazing. Isn't that fantastic? So powerful, and you can see that this is not the first time that marula tree has been subjected to the attentions of an elephant, and they have an incredible ability to deal with a large-scale trauma, as do many of the trees out here, and that's simply because of the elephants. They have to be able to deal with damage like that and keep growing, otherwise they couldn't survive out here. See what he does now. I mean, there's no real reason for him to break that down. He could have just pulled small pieces of it off. But there, you can see him eating now. So they also eat the marula leaves as well as the fruit. Sharon, very good suggestion from you. Let's see what this elephant does, and then I will do as you ask. You say it'd be a good idea for me to stand next to that tree and get a perspective of his size, and I'll absolutely do that for you. So take a screenshot now. Tebs will zoom out, and you can take a screenshot, and then I'll go and stand in front of the tree, and you can take a screenshot then. Take your screenshots now. Yeah. All right. And then I'll go and stand there when he moves off. He probably won't be able to see me. We're sitting about 30 meters from him now, about 100 feet. And for the moment, he's pretty comfortable with us. Beeping is just that VR rig. So, Cat Curly I think you're going to be pleasantly amazed by how enormous this animal is. You say, how tall is he? He stands at sort of under the bottom of the shoulder, so not the top of the shoulder, at about 6 feet. He's about 10 feet tall at the shoulder, maybe 11 feet. So he's pretty tall at the shoulder. And you'll see, just, I mean, look at him in comparison with that tree. I'm just 5 feet and 8 inches, and I reckon he's probably about double my size. Maybe not quite, but almost. James Taylor, for your comment that we should bring giant soccer balls into the bush here for the animals to play with, like he did with that that rock. James, I don't know that we're going to take you up on that suggestion, but maybe one day. I'm just going to try and slightly reposition us so that we're not staring straight into that sun. I don't want to disturb him because he's found a nice piece of tree to eat. Remember where I'm parked so that you can do a screenshot of my height versus his. And then one of the things we've been trying to do over the last 2 days is get identifying marks on these animals, trying to figure out, you know, what makes them easily identifiable. Now, with an elephant bull, the best thing to do is look at his tusks. And those are pretty clear, pretty obvious. And then you can also look at the sort of, I'm just going to gently ease in here and hopefully not irritate him. There we go. That's quite nice. We'll just stop here. I'm just going to lower my voice a bit because he now is watching us, but he seems to be pretty calm. He's feeding nicely. We've closed the distance to about 20 meters or 66 feet. So his tusks, those are pretty obvious, quite short, quite wide, quite sharp and equi-lengthed. Then you can look at his ears and the notches in his ears and maybe use those to identify different sizes, at least different individuals, but those ears will change all the time. They will be notched, differently. You know, you might see him in a week and he'll have another 4 or 5 notches in his ears. Safari Dean, you've asked a very good question. It does not matter. Just hold on tight, everybody. Sit still, Tibbs. Be very quiet. Sorry about the camera focus, everybody. We are struggling with it. I'm just going to be very quiet now, though, as we watch him feed here. Isn't this just unbelievable? I'm sure you can hear the leaves in his trunk. Dean, I will come back to your question as soon as I can talk a bit more loudly and my heart rate has returned to normal. That's 3 feet from us, everybody. And now he's widening the distance a bit. Wasn't that awesome? I'm going to let him go off into the bush there. Wonderful, wonderful shot. And thankfully I managed to record on the virtual reality rig. Safari Dean. So, sorry about the focus, everybody. That's why Tebs is zooming in on me, because he can't maintain focus and zoom out at the moment. I'm going to quickly answer Safari Dean's questions fast as possible so you don't have to look at my ugly mug, and then we'll send you back across to Scott. You want to know if elephants are afraid of us because they know that humans kill people? It's a complicated question, but in essence, yes. That is why they're afraid of us, but it goes way back. It goes back to our evolutionary past. For as long as our ancestors have been walking on 2 feet, they've been picking up stones and picking up sticks and throwing them at animals and killing the animals of Africa, because that's how we evolved. We evolved as hunters, scavengers as well, but also hunters, and so animals have an inherent fear of us, and that's basically why they show that kind of reaction sometimes. That was pure curiosity. He was just having a game with us. It was fantastic. I'm going to hand you back across to Scott. We'll go to the hyena den and I'll see you over there.
Well, it sounds like a wonderful sighting was had with that big Eli bull before he disappeared. I love seeing them display their size and strength. We just moved off for a comfort break. Leg stretch. Get some wind in our hair. And look what we found, not too far from the kill. And we need to stop and say thank you to this species of bird, the vulture. These are all white-backed vultures. And they are the ones that helped us to find this leopard. Not necessarily these three. There were many vultures. I'd say between 40 and 60 vultures, quite comfortably, in many dead trees in the surrounding areas around this kill. And quite an iconic scene to see them in a dead tree. They like the dead trees because it's easiest to land in and take off out of. And a lot of the bigger trees in this area that still do have leaves and small branches are very thorny, which means you obviously get tangled up in them. Thank you very, very much for sending me through a picture of that giraffe that was hoisted up into a tree at Pilansberg, and for letting us know a little bit more about it. Not sure whether apparently the back legs are now missing off the kill and you weren't entirely sure when those would have been removed off the carcass. So it's some interesting stuff, and thank you, Barbara, for sending it through. Gonna have to listen to the Game Drive channel. It's a bit of chaos at the moment with quite a lot of people around, and a lot of the people who are here are not full-time guides. They are merely landowners who are kind of a little bit rusty when it comes to the radio protocol, so nothing against them, but it does mean that I just need to make sure everything's under control here before it becomes out of control. Listening now, everything seems in order. What complicates things is that I've had earache and my ears are both so blocked that I can hardly hear what's going on, even with an earpiece plugged into my head. So I'm deaf and there's a lot going on, all making things a little bit tricky. James Bay in Kansas City. Thanks for asking about my earache. It is still bothering me. The black tape on my ear is actually to help keep the earpiece in place. I can't push the earpiece too far into my ear because there's so much other stuff going on in there. Anyway, not less about my ears, more about Safari, I think. But thank you for your concern.
They are not in a good state though, but are on the mend ever so slowly.
Slowly, Craig. So I want to try and get into a spot where our vehicle can fit, where we can see the leopard, but we're not going to be too much in the way of the other vehicles. And I think that will probably be somewhere right about here. So Liam, if you don't mind trying to see if we've got a little gap there. I think that's as good as it's going to get. Hello, my good friend Matty, just 9 years old, and always happy to hear that you are watching in Ohio. And Matty obviously heard me chatting about the snow leopards earlier and would like to know if they're the same as these leopards but just live in snowy areas, or if they are in fact different. And Matty, they are very, very different. They've got much longer hair, much bigger rosettes, those black marks that you can see on kind of Mr. Q's, the middle of his back now. You can see those kind of round spots or rosettes. And the rosettes of a ammo leopard or a snow leopard is quite a lot bigger. In terms of size, I'm not too sure, Matty, but their coloration is also different. They've got a more gray coloration than a yellowy coloration. And Matty, you're gonna have to ask somebody to help find you a picture of a snow leopard. I wish I could help you, but I don't have one in my book. So I've only got the leopards of Africa. The snow leopards occur elsewhere. I'm not actually sure, entirely sure where they occur. I think in Russia, in some parts of Russia. But Matty, good question, and I'm glad you are paying attention on Safari. And aren't we lucky again to have found this leopard after not seeing him for so long? And I hope you're doing well and have got a big smile on your face, Matty. Laura in New York City. I'm going to try and compete with the hornbills that are busy singing around us as I answer your question. And you would like to know how much of this panting is a result of the heat as opposed to the leopard digesting and the increase in energy required and heat from that digestion that is being broken down. So Laura, I think it's a combination of the two. It's a very hot afternoon. Obviously, the metabolism is increasing his body temperature to a degree. But not only that, there's a third factor you've missed out on, Laura, and that is the fact that his stomach is going to be full of meat, which is pushing up against his diaphragm, causing him to take shorter breaths. So if he wasn't full-bellied, yet he was still hot, he'd probably be able to maybe not pant as regularly and take bigger, deeper breaths. So there's three different things all kind of culminating in him panting. The ratios at which each of those three factors will be causing the panting, I'm not too sure. I'm happy to say 33 1/3% for each of them. 33% for heat, 33% for increased heat due to metabolism, and 33% due to pressure on the diaphragm from that full belly causing short, sharp breaths. So even in cool weather, they will still take these short, sharp breaths, is basically what I'm saying. And that's because of a full stomach. I'm just going to creep forward a tiny bit more, just to get a slightly clearer spot. There we go. Now the waiting game begins. The wind is blowing, and again, that's important for us to... Oh, big yawn. I hope some of you got some screenshots. And if you do not know how to take a screenshot, I strongly advise researching how to take one on whatever device you are watching on. It's good fun. You can post-produce the pictures, and you can just keep tabs on what you've seen and also how the animals change over the ages. Some of the viewers who've been following for many years now, or at least since the beginning of this specific Safari Live broadcast, which started November last year, would have had countless photos of this exact leopard this time last year and all the way in between till now. And what a great way to be able to document an animal's life, as well as what you see whilst on safari with us. Very happy to hear that we have some people on safari who are currently in the United Arab Emirates, and Kaki is busy trying to introduce his wife Karen to Safari Live. And Karen, a very, very warm welcome. And Kaki, thank you very much for spreading the word. The more people that join in on the safari will afford us greater opportunities to go elsewhere. So come on, Safari Live disciples, go out, spread the word, and then we will take you to more places. Well, at least that's my theory. Hello to Mercedes in San Francisco, and you are interested to know, why will tigers and lions not hoist their kills? And the reason for that, Mercedes, is that they have got no reason to. They can more often than not defend their kills from anything. They are at the top of their respective food chains. We don't get tigers here in Africa, only in India, and there you don't get hyenas as far as I'm aware. So, and even if you did, a tiger is big enough to swat a hyena out of contention. So that is the reason why they do not only not hoist their kills into trees, but it's also a big reason why they simply don't actually even climb into them. They don't have a reason to. Leopards have got a reason to, and that is to get their kill into a safe place, A, and B, they'll also use it to keep cool, but that's almost a secondary benefit of learning how to climb trees for a more pertinent use, and that is storing their food away from not only hyena, but also lion. Lion are not good climbers, and another thing that I must clear up, Mercedes, is that lion are far bigger than leopard, and that is lioness as opposed to a big male leopard. Your average lioness would weigh about 120 kilograms, whereas your big, big male leopards would only get up to 100. So, considerably larger. Lions can climb, but very well. So that must be said. And certain lions in certain areas are also better at climbing than others. You get some tree climbing lions in Tanzania, who specialize in climbing due to the fact that there are so many flies in that area that the only kind of place where you can get a little bit of peace and quiet is up in the trees. That camouflage as VM zooms out. Hello to Tiki, and thank you for letting us know where you are this time over in Baltimore. And for those of you who are new to the Safari Live experience, we really do like to know where you are watching, so please let us know if you can. Now, Tiki, oh, we're in luck. He's showing some signs of life. He may just be repositioning, or he may be heading across for another snack. Look at this. Isn't it beautiful when they get up and on the move? You get a far better idea of how impressive and immaculate they are. Tiki, I'll be with you in a second. Magical afternoon sunlight. And wouldn't it be nice to know what he's sniffing about there? Maybe that's where he made the kill initially, before dragging it off into the shade. Oh. That explains it a bit better. He's having a toilet break. And he was just trying to work out where would be the best spot. Sorry, Mr. Q. But thankfully he's chosen quite a good spot, and there are the perfect leaves and the perfect positions to prevent you seeing the things you don't want to see, necessarily. But still enough to see what's going on.
Yes.
Tiki, back to your question now that we've got a moment. Vultures will try to feed on kills that are up in trees, but it is unlikely. You can see how close he is to the vehicle up there. Yeah, interesting stuff. The animals are habituated to the vehicles. They are not tame. They are wild animals. And it's important that we remember they've been very gently exposed to these vehicles in a manner that makes them feel comfortable around us. We don't give them a hard time. Oh, well done. Very good practice that. Covering up your poop. It's probably not just from a hygiene perspective, but what he's trying to do is eliminate that terrible smell from wafting through the air and attracting any hyenas. I'm just going to reposition ever so slightly quickly.
No, no.
He's just about to arrive at the carcass. For his second feed this afternoon. So Tiki, usually if a kill is up a tree, battlers and vultures will certainly try and feed on it, but the leopard, if it's still around, will keep chasing them away. So there's nothing to stop them doing that, and they will do that, but it's something that I don't see very often, and that's because most of the time the leopard is there to make sure. Look at this. Straight into business. That was a bit of an error. That guy must feel like a bit of a clown for leaning on his horn, but it happens. It's happened to me. It happens to everyone. And it just gave the leopard a bit of a fright, but it won't take long for the leopard to recover. And it was not a malicious act by whoever it was that tonked on their horn there. I'm going to try and get us into a better spot now. Oh, this is the animal that I was hoping was going to pop into view. And it's just behind a bush. We are going to get into position. We're going to send you up into the sky on the drone. There's some great stuff happening across there.
Look at that spectacular shot in the golden light as the sun starts to set. I did check the hyena den, nothing there at the moment. So we've come to these giraffe at Drone Commander Francis, driven by, look at the little one running, driven by Brent Leo Smith, has found wonderful stuff. And then just off to my right-hand side, and probably in front of you, there is another female. She's hiding behind the bush over there. There we go. And we'll zoom in on her as she lurks there behind the bushes. Oh, we can't even see her. I think I've parked Kebs behind the only bush that I could have parked him behind. Anyway, there she is. You got her now, Kebs? There we go. And they're part of the same little group. Two females and their little baby. Beautiful. She, that female that you first saw when you came across to us with the drone, actually looked like she was going to pluck it out of the sky at one stage. She wasn't actually really going to do that, but she was looking straight at it. Giraffe are tremendously inquisitive. And she was walking straight towards it, and she tried to grab it. Oh, well, she didn't try and grab it. She looked like she might. Okay, let's go back to the leopard. He's eating his well-earned meal, and we'll keep with these giraffe for a little bit longer.
Well, I hope you enjoyed your quick flight, and it sounds like some beautiful scenes from the air. And a little bit more gory. Flies all over this carcass. We're quite lucky he's moving around. We haven't got into the perfect spot yet. There's two other vehicles here, and we're all just trying to get into a good spot so we can all get a good view. But for now, this isn't too bad, and I'm just going to creep forward a little bit closer. This is good. And I know Joey was asking earlier about how many teeth are in the leopard's mouth. Well, now you're going to get to see these teeth in action. And what you'll find is they'll use the majority of the time their teeth on the side of their mouth, which will act like scissors. And those will slice through the meat and the bones. Now, even though he's probably full, he knows that as darkness is beginning to set in, the likelihood of hyena and lion or other leopard arriving is increasing, and that's going to be putting added pressure on him, and he's going to be doing his best to try and get as much of this kill into his belly as possible. If he had it hoisted up into the safety of the tree, I think he wouldn't be inclined to feed now. But it's good for us. It means we're getting to see an active leopard as opposed to a sleepy one. And for those of you who are new to Safari Life, we do spend a lot of time with sleeping cats, and you're being spoilt with some quite good action here without having to show too much patience. Oh, I'm glad I'm not having to stick my head in there. Oof. Look at that. Some wonderful feedback from Wayne, who's watching on YouTube. And Wayne, I couldn't agree more with you. We should be doing more marketing, and should have been doing more marketing, but happy that at least you discovered us during Big Cat Week on Nat Geo Wild. I will pass on your thoughts to my boss and tell him to bolster up our marketing team. And Wendy in Aspen,
great to know that you're watching. And sorry, Debbie in Aspen. Sorry to hear that it is a freezing 6 degrees Fahrenheit there. Whew. And it is a beautiful, beautiful place though. And as cold as you may be, I'm sure you are very happy and privileged. And you know that you're privileged to be there. I have visited there for a few months back in my youth. And it is a fairy tale town. I look forward to returning there in the summer months. It looks like a beautiful playground with lots of hiking and fishing and fun activities to do. But the winter months were certainly a wonderful, wonderful experience for me. Now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to keep quiet for a second and let's see if we can't listen to him crunching through these bones. Can you believe that this is happening this very second in Africa? It's a beautiful evening. And this magnificent male leopard is cashing in on a hard-won meal. It's a very large prey to bring down. They're not going to bring down prey too much larger than this leopard. And it's probably close on double his size. Imagine the wrestling match. That kudu wouldn't have gone down without a fight and would have been trying its best to kick the leopard off its. Well, please excuse me, but this is a magical, magical moment, and I am going to get my camera out and snap off a few pics. If any of you are interested in looking at any of my pictures from the past and or videos, I would suggest logging on to my Facebook page, Scott Dyson Safaris, and that way you can look back into the past of what has happened. You'll get a lot of pictures of this leopard from the past, as well as a few videos. And you'll also then be able to, I guess, see what all of this snapping is all about that you hear. Good afternoon, Big Dave, who's watching in Florida. What has happened? Was it the flies, Mr. Q? It was. He simply just all of a sudden had enough of those flies and hopped up and thought, enough's enough. I'm coming to relax. Ooh, what has he found here? Oh, look at this. This is an organ he's removed. And this is exactly where he took the fetus from earlier. As we arrived onto the scene this morning, the fetus was in the exact same place where he is now. Now, I think that this is an organ that he's plucked out of the carcass, possibly the liver or the lungs. Hard to say. I'm just going to reverse the vehicle ever so slightly. I'm in the way of the other people. Sorry, Greg. That should work. They should all have a good view now. Well, wasn't that a surprise? All of a sudden, he just jumped up and came running towards us. I thought there was a hyena on its way in. Now we can see what it is. I can't work out what that is exactly. Big chunk of meat. But that's all I'm willing to hazard at the moment. Now, is he going to take this up a marula tree? I think he might. Either way, we're going to follow him and we're going to find out. So this is exciting stuff. Hold on, everybody. Just
to let you know, Craig, he moved the fetus down towards the riverbed in the same direction he's going now, earlier this morning. Well, we're on the move. And isn't this fun? Again, for those of you who are new, we are as sensitive as possible whilst off-roading, and the trees that we do drive over, pop back up. We know which tree is which. It's part of our job requirement. And certain trees are inclined to snap. We obviously don't drive over those. The ones that are not inclined to snap are the ones we do drive over. I'm going to take a chance and get right ahead of him so we get some great shots of him walking towards us. Hold on, everybody. Put down your drinks if you are having one. We'll drink faster. Please may this gamble pay off. It's not looking good at this stage. But I also did want to make space for all of those other vehicles and actually just leave them behind us. And we are more maneuverable than them, so I'm trying to make the most of that maneuverability in this much shorter car. And I think it's going to pay off. Then you can just watch very closely and let me know if you see the leopard there. Okay. Pop up just in front of us at any second now. Interesting. We're ahead of schedule, so that's good. He's still on his way towards us, and it's going to work out magically. Hello, Petra in Amsterdam, who's busy decorating their Christmas tree. Good to know you're doing that. And how heavy do you think he is the question I've got from Petra. I'm guessing around 80 kilograms, maybe a bit more. Look at this, coming straight towards us. And what is probably going to happen is he's going to reveal to us where he has this kudu kill stashed, the kudu fetus.
It's a male.
So that's going to be very interesting. I wonder where it's going to be. Look at this beautiful afternoon sunlight on him. It doesn't get better than this, everyone. It really doesn't. What I'm going to do though is I'm going to move now. I hope that we're going to see him climbing up a tree. And I think it's the street just ahead of us. I'm going to have to be quick. Otherwise, we're going to miss it. Is there a kudu dangling somewhere in this tree, or is he going deeper into the riverbed? What he may have done and what he looks to be doing now is unraveling the kudu that he may well have just buried under some leaf litter. I'm going to reposition again now that I can see he's not going up the tree. So he's just slunk off. You'll be able to get a glimpse of his bottom there. He left the meat on that little kind of log above him. There we go. And now I think he's going to pull out the kudu fetus. Is going to be here. And that is what he's sniffing around for now.
What's going on, Mr. Q? Now, everyone, I am listening to the Game Drive channel, so I am focusing on that as well. There's going to be a lot of people asking me exactly what's going on, so I just need to keep them in mind as we try and enjoy this as much as we can. What will your next move be, Mr. Q? Are you going to show us where you have this kudu foal stashed? Are we overlooking it? Is it somewhere easy to see? I think he just lay down up ahead here. Let's go and have a look. Some awesome news. VM's just spotted the fetus of the kudu. It's not going to be easy to see. I need to maybe move forward a little bit. It's a shame. That's the baby unborn kudu. And shame, isn't that sad? But it is nature. And there's a lot of people that are asking, what antelope is this? Monique in London, Molly with her whole class of students, Tiance and Margate, and many more. It should answer your question now. For those of you who were wondering, now we need to keep an eye on this leopard. He was, here he is. He's, okay, good. We can reposition, he's just lay up in a bush, or behind this bush, so we're not gonna be able to see it from here. Interesting stuff though, and aren't we so lucky to be able to witness this fascinating behavior. He's come here, stashed the kudu, the baby kudu fetus, and now he's brought another chunk of meat here in preparation for the long and probably tough night ahead of him. He's going to have hyena coming into that other kill, and maybe he's already just written it off and thought, you know what, I'm not even going to bother. I've got my little snack here. I'm going to leave the kudu and be in peace, and not only be in peace, but be in safety. Well spotted there, VM. Leslie, in California. I wish I knew the answer to your question. I've never seen a leopard successfully bring down a kudu live in the flesh, and I've actually seen very, very few kills in my entire working life. It is something we seldom get to see, and it's a huge luck to be able to witness an actual takedown. And because I've never watched a leopard take down a kudu, I've got very little insight into how long it would take. But I'm willing to say it would be a couple of minutes of actual wrestling before the leopard fatigues the kudu enough to the point that it'll be even a few more minutes before the kudu will die of suffocation. Now, to give you a story that you can relate to, for those of you who were watching The Drive with Peter Pretorius in October, that did go to Nat Geo Wild, let's take a look at the leopard while I tell you the story. As Peter arrived on the scene, that impala was still kicking. But the impala was caught, I would say, 5 minutes before Peter got there. I was on foot tracking that leopard and heard the impala. As soon as she caught that impala, the rest of the herd started alarm calling very, very loudly. And it took me about 5 minutes to get into that position and get Peter into that position. And that impala was still alive and kicking even 5 minutes after being caught. So that gives you an idea of how long it can take a female leopard to kill an impala, and I guess a kudu for a male leopard is going to be a slightly harder task than a female impala for a female leopard. So I would say, yeah, I mean, the minimum 5 minutes, but possibly 10, 15, who knows? Also, what we don't know, and we've discussed earlier for those of you who've just joined the safari, is that we have no idea whether this kudu was possibly in labor, actually giving birth to this fetus that we've just seen. I personally don't think so. I think it's something that was going to happen in the future, but we cannot be certain. I'm just going to get onto the radio quickly and ask if anybody wants an update on the sighting after we've been rushing about. Are any stations looking for an update on quarantine? He's lying up next to the fetus and a small chunk of organ. I'm not sure what organ it is that he's brought further away from the kill. Go ahead, Johan. That's affirmative. If you are heading north up Galago shortcut from Vuyatela access, it's not the first two track that you see north of the waterhole access, it's the second two track that you see. Copy, perfect. If you have any trouble, let me know. Okay, well, we are in luck. The leopard is on the move again. Johan, one of the other landowners out here, is wanting some better directions to the hyena den. And I've heard James quickly making sure that Johan lets him know if... Oh, isn't this beautiful? That little moment there with that leopard's coat washing through the green foreground. Oh, it's my favorite seeing these shots. It gives you such a good idea of the terrain and also how quickly these animals can disappear. Well, Bob G has just asked, do I think he has abandoned the kudu? And I thought maybe he had, but it's unlikely that he would completely abandon it. And I think he's on his way back there now, Bob G. So let us go and see. Just trying to get my bearings here of exactly where we are, looking for good monuments to be able to find our way back here, if not tonight, tomorrow morning. I think I've got enough of a map printed into my head now of where we need to go. The leopard's off to our left. He was moving back up towards the road. Okay. He's got a visual of him, he's straight ahead of us. So, we can calm down to a pack. Am I hearing you correctly? Yeah. Oh, stationary, sorry. Okay. Cool, thank you. Gracie, and very, very happy to hear that you're watching again, and thanks to your mom for letting you watch. Gracie, just like your mom says, that baby kudu and her mom are in kudu heaven, and kudu heaven is a very, very peaceful place, and they're having a very good time there. And it is sad, of course, that they cannot live with us here on earth anymore, but they're in heaven with lots of other kudus and lots of other people like us that are no longer on earth, and there's nothing to really worry about. It has to happen, Gracie, and it is hard to watch, that we must remember, and it's, of course, it's sad, but we must always remember that there are positive that happens, things that happen even when it's quite sad. So we must remember to always think positively and remember that something good is happening, and the something good that happens here is that the kudu have gone to a better place. So Gracie, happy to hear you watching. We have to be tough when we're on safari, and I know it's sad, but it does need to happen. We all know that leopards and lions eat meat. If we could convince them to eat carrots and potatoes, that would be great, but I don't think they would like it very much.
we can get you a view of him just slinking off there.
There he goes. Jackie's class. Some of you have really got some nice teachers that allow you to watch Safari Live. And Jackie, thank you. And Abby, thank you for sending through your question. Abby's interested to know, is there a specific order that leopards may feed on specific organs within a kill? And Abby, not that I have personally noticed, but I think there could well be one. I just simply don't know the answer to that question. But the liver and the lungs are nice and soft. So those will be sought after and also quite easy to get to when opening up a carcass. So I'm guessing those are probably going to be the first two that go. But it will depend on the individual leopard and I guess the carcass that they're feeding on, you know. These leopards or at the moment that are making the kills of the pregnant female herbivores are often going to pluck that fetus out first. We've noticed that with Karula. We've noticed that now with Quarantine. It appears like Mr. Q may have temporarily disappeared. He, interestingly enough, isn't heading straight back to the kill, which is more in that direction. So maybe he's looking for a puddle to drink out of. We're going to keep trying to find him and again send you to some beautiful scenes with James and the drone.
Hello, everybody. We've just come to look at the sort of setting sun here, the Drakensberg behind, hidden by some clouds. And mainly, not so that you can look at my ugly mug sitting on the dashboard, but so that you can see it from the air. The drone seems to be now positioned and ready. Have a look at this. Isn't that wonderful? I can't see exactly what you're seeing, but I imagine that that sort of golden tablecloth that is covering the top of the clouds there looks spectacular from there, from where you're watching it. And you can see us sitting here. I mean, we could wave at you, I suppose. And then the big road that you can see just to the sort of between us and the mountains is the road. Well, I mean, it's just next, just in front of us is the boundary between us and Arethusa. So we obviously are unable to cross that boundary. Or we can cross that boundary, sorry. But this is one of the property boundaries that humans of the area have drawn that the animals can ignore. It's also the territorial boundary between, quite interestingly, between Karula and between her daughter Shadow. You can probably, you may also be able to see Andrew flying himself. He's probably trying to get a little picture of himself. It's called a drone selfie. He's not too far behind us. He's just over there. Amazing stuff. I find these aerial shots utterly astonishing. Anyway, that's what the case is there. We are going to have one last go at the hyena den. And then we'll see what happens. Apparently somebody went in there about 10 minutes after we left the hyena den, and there were a couple of adults there, no babies yet. So we'll go in there and see if we can't get a space and hopefully see those little hyenas and try and unravel some of the mystery behind what's going on there. Right, here we go. So you can come with us. Scott is still trying to find the leopard, so you're going to come with us. And turn around this way, and then unavoidably Andrew's going to get a selfie of himself sitting with Brent Leo Smith. There you go, there you can see them. And Brent is now shaking his head, of course, because he feels very remiss of me to film him on his night off. But it's actually Andrew who's filming him, it's not me. Right. See you later, Brenty. Do you want to reset the camera quickly, Sid? Now, Jeff Topp, a very good question from you. You want to know, can we check for the Birmingham boys with the drone? We could, but we also, much as airspace over countries is restricted, so is airspace over game reserves. So we can't just fly over any piece of the reserve that we want to. Now, I'm afraid to, well, I mean, half afraid and half astonished to bring you the following news. The Birmingham boys have just killed 3 buffalo in front of the Cheetah Plains Pan, which is obviously on Cheetah Plains. So just astonishing stuff. They apparently went down to have a drink. Some buffaloes didn't see them, and so they knocked off 2 youngsters and I think an adult cow. So they're not going to be going anywhere from Cheetah Plains anytime soon. I think we won't be seeing those 4 Birmingham boys for some time. Sorry about that. Wonderful for them, I suppose. Not so wonderful for the buffalo. So like I say, we're going to take one more look at the hyena den, and while we drive there post-haste, Scott has managed to relocate his spotted friend. Let's head across to him, and I'll see you just now.
So some interesting behavior that we are lucky enough to witness here, and these shots are just too good, and I'm loving every single second of this, as should all of you. He's looking for a puddle of water, and he's zigzagging from mud wallow to mud wallow. And now that he has disappeared out of shot, I'm probably going to ask VM just to show you where he's come from, which is just in front of us, and you'll see a few little barren patches of earth there, and those are potentially sometimes filled with water after rains. And he's busy walking around checking some likely spots, hoping to find a little bit to drink to wash down that kudu. Remember quite a funny moment spent with this very same cameraman, VM, and we had been watching Kunyuma feed on a dika, small antelope, and he had caught it in the morning, fed on it in the morning, finished it off in the afternoon, I think, and we followed him to the Juma waterhole where to stay with him, and what should I do? We're trying to keep an eye on him. Anyway, Kunyuma, this leopard's brother, eventually got to the Juma waterhole to have a drink, and the comment that came out of VM's mouth after Kunyuma had been drinking for about 5 or 6 minutes was that diker must have been very salty. And I burst into laughter, and I'm sure VM's thinking the same thing now, that this kudu must be quite salty because it's caused Mr. Q to head off in search of a drink. He's somewhere off to our right, and it's going to be tricky following him on his quest for a puddle, but it would be wonderful if we do get to show you him drinking. Here he is again, so that's good news. He's about to cross this tiny little riverbed that we're about to attempt to cross. This will be an easy one to cross. I'm just trying to rearrange my wig. It's looking a little bit messy, as you can see. That's what you get on a live safari. I wonder if he's not going to find something. There's quite a lot of rocks in this riverbed. It's quite a rocky riverbed, and maybe he'll get lucky and find a puddle somewhere. But I think he has already crossed across. To Monique in London, and yes indeed, very, very hard to watch that little baby kudu without feeling deep, deep sorrow, and I couldn't agree more, Monique. And how long, I think, before it would have been given birth to? Oh, it's so tricky to say, but not very long. I mean, maybe a week, 2 weeks at the most, maybe a little bit longer. But very tricky to tell from the brief glimpses that we've got. very difficult to tell from the brief glimpses that we have got, Monique. Barbara and Christine, certain things that these wild animals do cannot be explained, and why he has not very easily hoisted the chunk of meat as well as that kudu fetus up into this tree is beyond me. I mean, it's so easy to do, but maybe that's his exact thoughts. He knows how easy it is, but he's taking a risk. He definitely is taking a risk, but by not preempting the hyenas arriving. But I've seen successful adult female leopards who've raised many litters. Sometimes they'll hoist a kill, sometimes they won't, even if it's the same kill, a small kill like a duiker. Even sometimes when they've got cubs, they'll feed on the ground with their cubs. Cubs kill chaos. Not a good move, but it happens. And what we need to remind ourselves is that we as humans have developed powerful brains, more powerful brains than most of the animals on the planet, I think it's fair to say. And that's why we are the apex animal running around causing trouble. Animals, though, have got instinct, they've got brute strengths, and they've got certain things programmed into their brains that may not be well explained, and kind of it may make sense that they are not the smartest animals on the planet and that we are, but it therefore becomes difficult for our brain to comprehend their thought processes, because I've often thought to myself, these animals are just not thinking clearly, but they do a lot that we cannot do, and they're doing a great job at it. It's very successful, it's doing a good job at surviving, it's hunting, it's killing, and as you can see, it's prospering. But certain things regarding brain power, a lot of the animals do lack. If they had a bigger brain or a brain like ours, together with their body and their strength and their speed and their agility, they would be a force to be reckoned with, and maybe leopards would rule the planet. But again, brain power, sometimes not so good in the wild animals. Instinct, yes. Power, yes. Agility, yes. But sometimes they are not the cleverest of the animals on the planet. At least that's my opinion. Because surely, if a hyena has stolen from you once, or twice, or even three times, that would be less than enough to take your kills into trees. There are many different leopards that we can look at. Shadow, another offspring from the same mother as this leopard, although much older than Quarantine. She's about 9 years old now. She too doesn't always hoist her kills, and therefore, a lot of the time they get stolen, and that could be a reason why she's lost a lot of her cubs. It could also just be misfortune and bad luck. She may have lost her cubs for other reasons. Are you going to go back to the kudu for us now? I think you should. He's heading in the right direction, and that's where we want him to be. I was almost thinking of leaving him here and going and waiting there to see what arrives, because it's that stage of the evening that we could be expecting some visitors at the kudu buffet that is lying in wait. Jacqueline in Georgia. Jacqueline is not convinced that Quarantine killed this kudu. I was just querying my thought process as to why do I think he killed it and not presume that he may have stolen it from another predator. And I think Jacqueline's reason for thinking this is, well, I know it is because a kudu is large. And Jacqueline, you're right, a kudu is large. But it wouldn't make sense for a larger predator to be able to catch the kudu and then be overthrown by a smaller predator like a leopard. So that would rule out that theory. If a big lioness caught that kudu, it would be big enough to keep Quarantine away. So that's one side of the story. Then the other side of the story is that there's no other side of the story, actually. That's the end of that, I think, Jacqueline, because if it was a smaller predator, yes, but then it wouldn't make sense because then the small predator wouldn't have been able to do it. So leopards are certainly capable of catching kudu-sized prey, and he has caught kudu in the past, an adult female kudu. It was, I think, in March when we were doing some more Big Cat Week, not Big Cat Week, Nat Geo TV broadcasts, that Brent found quarantine on a adult female kudu kill. I can't remember what happened to that though, whether it got stolen by hyena, what the outcome was.
I was recording kudu about 4 months ago.
Okay, and VM says now that he also caught a kudu about 4 months ago. I can hear hyenas, I think, and the leopards running on. Come on, everyone. Oh, it's the vultures. It's the smelly vultures. But they've already run off. He got there before we did and chased the vultures away. But all of a sudden his ears pricked up and he started rushing towards the kill. And then so we did. Sorry if we left any of you behind or if any of you fell off. My heart is racing. And I just want to show you one quick view of a vulture. And that wasn't here. This was the same dead tree that we showed you earlier. And look how its head and neck is black. And that is because it's wet. And it's wet with blood it's been feeding on. I'm just going to try and get a spotlight out quickly. And then the light will be able to help you see that blood on his neck. There we go. Good. Well, we're going to get you across to the hyena den quickly, and we'll be back shortly.
And there we go, everybody. That is the seven-week-old hyena, and interestingly, the what we've termed the manky mum is not around at the moment. This is the pretty mother, and without that clearly more probably more dominant female that we had here this morning, the one who had the twin youngsters, without her here, that seven-week-old has come out of the den and is now wandering around playing just like she was before the arrival of the manky mum and her twins. Now, I don't know if perhaps the manky mum's the other side there. That's quite possible. But I haven't seen what's going on there. Isn't that wonderful? So, lots of questions about what would happen to the seven-week-old. Well, she's clearly out. She looks in fine fettle. She's playing happily. I'm sure she's getting enough to eat, and all is well with her. Very exciting stuff. We'll just sit here. Remember, we're not going to spend too long here just because it is getting dark and we're not going to shine any light on this thing. So what we'll do is sit for 2 minutes here and then we'll go around to the other side and see if anything else is going on there. Look at that, isn't that wonderful? Sleepy one, you were wondering how that cub is. There's your answer. Absolutely fine. And this is exactly how we've been viewing this den for the last little while until the arrival of Manky Mum and her two twins. Well, maybe one twin, maybe two. That sort of mid-aged female, her little baby youngster and the six-month-old, who I think is born to the matriarch of this clan. And they're all sort of very comfortably living around each other. Far more comfortably, it would seem, than they were this morning when that less than attractive female was here with her very little one, which is only 2 weeks old. I Alice, a very good postulation. I mean, we sat here the whole of this morning hoping to see this little one. We saw her head stick out of the hole, then she disappeared back inside, and the Mangi mother was lying precisely where this mother is lying now. And Alice, you want to know, perhaps she gets braver during the night time or dark. No, I don't believe so. And the only reason I don't believe so, and I say this with quite a lot of certainty, is that we've seen this kind of activity in broad daylight in the morning time around when we were here this morning. So I don't think it's got anything to do with the light. I think it's got to do with the highly stratified social structure that the hyenas have. Now I don't know what's going on. This is interesting. This is unbelievable. Who on earth is this female calling out of the den now? Look at this. She's gone in to try and call out another cub. This is bizarre. So this is very unusual because we're not really sure. We thought that this female only had that little cub. Why her head should be down there, who she's calling, I can't imagine. Let's see what happens. You see, time like this at a den like this is so valuable. Guess from one of the directors, I shan't tell you which one, says she's surely not forgetting that her cub is out of the den. Maybe. I don't know what else she could have been doing. I think it's worth going around the other side. Let's just nip around there quickly before it gets too dark. Say, not going to put a light on here. Tight in here. Anyway, we've had a great view of the 7-week-old. I didn't think we were going to get, or I was hopeful we would, but I didn't know. The Mangi mum sitting there, if I'm not very much mistaken. And no, look, there's the tiny little one, Tibbs, can you see it? So that isn't the Mangi mum we're looking at. I think the Mangi one is in the hole there. She's got a big piece out of her ear. Yeah, that's the one in front there. So the one in front, I don't know who that is. This is fantastic. Look at this. Just incredible stuff. Sorry, I do know exactly who that is. That's the mother of the 7-week-old who's just come down to the side. Fascinating. Look at this. here? You wanted to know how far away a hyena is able to smell a carcass. Yeah, quite a distance. You're in Illinois, not quite that far. Look at this hyena coming right close to us. That was about 4 feet. And here comes the six-month-old Mia. This little one is now getting very brave. Mia, a carcass would probably be smelt from at least 5 or 6 kilometers away, so 4 or 5 miles, perhaps. And I mean, it would have to be a pretty rank carcass at that stage. And perhaps you're wondering about the carcass that quarantine is eating at the moment. I think that's probably, well, I mean, if it was really stinky, if it had got particularly ripe in the sun, then absolutely they could probably smell it that far away. He's probably about 4 kilometers away from us now. Not quite, 3 kilometers as the crow flies. This is incredible to watch. Just we've got one more minute here, everybody, and then we're going to leave here and hand you back to Scott for the final few minutes with a beautiful cat. Mother Nature, you say maybe the pretty mother is a babysitter. I don't think a babysitter. I do think subordinate, though, to the manky mum. And I think that's why she's making these noises. I think she's being quite sort of subordinate. I don't understand it entirely. The 7-week-old's gone back into her den. That's where they're standing now. That's what you can see. And as Raisa says from Finland, Raisa, good observation as always, you say it's interesting that the 7-week-old cub did not respond to the call that her mother made. Absolutely, it really is astonishing. It's fascinating to spend time like this, with this incredible social stratification. Now the 6-month-old is going to have a look for the very little one. It's just 2 weeks old. That's amazing. And I wish I could interpret it with more skill. All right, so thank you, everybody. It's been a fantastic afternoon. Just a perfect temperature. Wonderful to have the drone up in the sky and wonderful to spend some time with that incredible elephant bull. Thank you, Tibbs, for your efforts today, especially with the focus troubles. Thanks, Nikki and Louise in the final control. We're going to hand you back to Scott. And he's with Liam at the moment for the final few minutes with that leopard. We'll see you tomorrow morning at 0500. Stay safe and happy wherever you are. Bye-bye and thanks a lot.
You wouldn't believe it, but look at how much of the carcass has been fed on. And you haven't missed on Mr. Q feeding on it. While he was away with us looking for a puddle of water to drink from, the vultures had swooped down. And look at how much they managed to feed on. Fascinating. He's lying up not too far away, just under this bush here. And sadly, the sunset safari has come to a close. We are going to show you a glimpse of him before we say goodbye. But first, thank you everyone for joining. Thank you to all the questions you sent through, thoughts, opinions, and all the help you've given me. Well done to Nikki and Louise in the final control room for directing this afternoon safari, as well as to VM on camera, who did some great camera work and got you some incredible views of this beautiful male leopard. And that's exactly what he's going to do right now. See you next time. It will be very interesting to see what happens here in the morning, so be sure to tune into the Sunrise Safari. There you can see Q hidden in the shadows, and let's hope he has a good night.